Amen. Amen. And that is our message. That is our work, to declare the gospel to the ends of the earth. Let's stand together, may we? We'll sing together in just a moment. Let's go to God in prayer and ask His blessing on this service. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to You and we're looking unto You. We're trusting in You in this hour. And God, we are glad that You're here with us. You say where two or three are gathered in Your name, in the midst You'll be. And we're glad for that. Thank You for the great promise that we can come together and we can discover You amongst us. And so, God, do a mighty work, we pray. Allow us to see it, behold it. Let us hear tonight and hearken and do Your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hymn number 318, we're standing on the promises of Christ my King. We're going to sing as Brother Collins comes to lead us. Hymn number 318.
Let's sing it out on that first. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Verse 2, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, I'm standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. On that third, standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Wonderful. Wonderful. I'm glad resting in His promises and standing upon His word. We cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. It's speaking about walking in the Spirit of the Lord, being filled with His Spirit. And my, if we could all be filled with the Spirit of God. Be filled and keep being filled and get filled again and filled once more. What a great thought that is. We can be filled with the Spirit the moment of our choosing. He desires to fill us. And He desires for you and me to walk with Him. It's our choice. He's ready to fill. He's already in us. It's just a matter of whether or not how much of us we are willing to give to Him. And He wants us. Sometimes I find myself singing these songs, just my mind's a million miles away. But the moment I choose to think about the Lord and to sing with joy and to think on the words and what I'm saying, it's in that moment I've made that decision to worship God. And truth just hammers the heart and fills the spirit. And so anytime you want to breathe, just breathe. Just breathe in and be filled with the Spirit of God. Yeah, He'll help us. The choir is singing a song entitled Wonder Working Power. Praise the Lord. I enjoyed that. Amen. Is that part of what we'll be hearing on Sunday? Great. I'm looking forward to the church choir and the children and the youth, all of them singing part of this special cantata on Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday. I want to encourage you to be here and be a part of it all. Praise the Lord for the wonder-working power. I'm going to ask our ushers to come if they would. They have a special little card in their hand. If someone could make their way to the choir as well. And choir, we're going to let you be seated if you don't mind for just a moment. Someone making their way to the choir. These are prayer request cards. We want to be sure and get your prayer request on Monday and Tuesday, starting at 6 o'clock. We'll be having a 24-hour prayer vigil. This means that people in our church are going to come for a one-hour period on Monday, starting at 6 o'clock, until Tuesday, ending at 7 o'clock. We're going to pray. I think it's maybe it's ending at 6 o'clock. We're going to pray for a 24-hour period, and you'll come in. Many of you have signed up already for this 24-hour prayer vigil. You'll come into the auditorium. There'll be stacks of prayer requests. Good. There'll be stacks. Thank you. I appreciate it so much. There'll be stacks of prayer requests and all over the auditorium, and you'll go privately, and you'll gather this little stack of prayer requests, and you'll pray privately, individually. Maybe you and your wife, maybe you alone, maybe you and some children under wing. And you'll pray and you'll ask God for these requests that will be left in these areas. And you'll work your way all around the auditorium, whatever pattern you want to work. And you'll pray for 1 hour. You remember the Lord talked about His disciples. Can you not tarry and pray with me but 1 hour? We'll pray for 1 hour. Asking God to do something special, praying for all the events this week, and with the Belt and Bible Days, the Easter Sunday, of course, and in the beginning of May is our youth conference. We'll be praying for all these events, asking God to do something special. But if you have a prayer request, a loved one that doesn't know Christ, or you have a special need in your home or your family or someone at work, and you're asking God to do something, I want to encourage you to leave that request with us. So I'm going to ask these men if they would to hand these out. There's a place on here for your first name, and if you want to, if your name's Susie and you want to call your name Sally, feel free to do so. It's not going to bother me. Or don't put a name, just put a request. We'll pray for you, and we'll pray for God to work in that area of your life or with your friend or your loved one. All right? Please be discreet in these. I know you will. If you need more room, there's room on the back. Feel free to fill those out. In just a little while, we'll receive our offering. I want to encourage you, feel free to drop them in the offering plate. Or if you'd like, there's a little box outside in the foyer. You're free to leave your prayer requests there at the table that lists that, okay? I want to encourage you to leave a request so we can pray. Many of you have great burdens. Well, we need to take them to the Lord, and we need to leave them there. I do want to encourage you as well, if you haven't signed up for the 24-hour prayer vigil, do that. Someone this morning said to me that someone had come to them and said, I don't know if I can pray for 24 hours. We're not asking you to pray for 24 hours. We're asking you to pray for 1 hour out of the 24 hours. And so get signed up. The Bible says where two or three are gathered. And so we already have a leader that's going to be here, and he'll give you just some simple instructions of how to get started, that kind of thing. And then he'll have you pray, and you'll pray alone. You won't pray out loud. You'll pray by yourself. And when it's all said and done, you'll leave. But where two or three are gathered. And so we want to encourage you to gather together, and let's pray and take these requests to the Lord. We have about 25 to 30 requests from the community that were gathered up, brought back, and came in online. And we have a number of requests already from the church. We're praying that God will give us some more so we can pray. We can pray. And we'll give those to you. But be a part of it all. Do you believe in the power of prayer? Amen. Good. Then you're going to want to be a part of all of this. You're going to want to put your request in. You're going to want to pray. All right? Good. Let's all stand to our feet, maybe. We're going to sing together. Bust them in, bust them in. There's a call come ringing. Is that correct? No. Yes. Bust them in. 416. Hark, 'tis the shepherd's voice I hear. Good job, choir.
Hark, 'tis the shepherd's voice I hear. Out in the desert, dark and drear. Calling the sheep who've gone astray. Far from the shepherd's fold.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. 282. On that first.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and for.
shake hands, greet one another, greet our visitors. Sing it out on that third verse as we make our way back to our seats. I think of my blessed Redeemer.
I think of my blessed Redeemer. I think of him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeem, redeem, redeem by the blood of the child, and forever I am. On the last, I know I shall see in his beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeem, redeem, redeem by the blood of the Lamb.
Pray for two of our missionaries tonight. We're praying, first of all, for the Elzy family, and they're serving the Lord faithfully in Bolivia. They have their new church building, and just this last month, they had their first year anniversary. And he said the whole church pitched in. He said they were cleaning bathrooms, painting, passing out invitations to the anniversary service. He said it was something that everybody had an opportunity, where there was a place that they could be a part. And he said that Sunday they had over 300 people in attendance. Three got saved and four were baptized. And so he said he's praising the Lord for it. He also sends a special thank you to those who have supported their ministry. He says using those funds that they were able to receive, he said they purchased their first bus for their bus ministry. And so he said he and another man flew about 2 weeks ago. He said they flew out to Santa Cruz and had a 30-hour drive back, driving a bus back. And he said, but they're excited to have it. They're really looking forward to it. He said, we had no problems the whole way back. And he said, that's a good sign if you can make a 30-hour trip with no problems. And so he asks us to pray for them, to pray for their son Matthew as well, as he's taking the next step in his life, and he's going to be away from the home. And so they're just praying for wisdom, direction in his life. So let's pray with them for that, for their bus ministry and for their church there. Lord's blessing in a wonderful way. We're also praying for the Woodard family. They are serving the Lord in Guyana. And I mentioned last Sunday, I believe, about their in-laws, the Hoffmeisters. We're talking about them because of their grandson. And so the Woodards are very excited. They have just brought their son back to the mission field. But at the time of writing their last letter, just about 2 weeks ago, his sending church, his home pastor of the last 24 years, went to be with the Lord. Brother Pastor Cavaness was his pastor. And so he asks that we pray for his home church, and then also for his dad, who is the assistant pastor there. He said they're grieving, and he said, but they know that they'll see him one day in heaven, and they're looking forward to that. And so let's pray for their for that, his home church, and then also pray for New Life Baptist Church, which is the church they have there in Guyana. He said as soon as they got back, he said he hit the ground running because they were wanting to have a revival, and so they had a lot of preparations to get started. It was the first revival that they've ever had at their church, and the Lord blessed it in a wonderful way. He said they were able to see 8 people get saved from it, and every night they average 60 to 70 people, which is great for a new church. And so they're praising the Lord for what he's doing there. He said, pray for us. We've been very busy since getting back. He said, as soon as we got back with our son Jason, one of the first things that we wanted to do is have running water in our house. And so he said he's been trying to do plumbing in their house recently. And so pray for him. He said, pray for wisdom. And then he also has a few things to, as praises. He said, pray for one of the women in their church. They call them aunties over there. And she's been a Hindu her whole life, and she trusted Christ as her Savior, and she's been coming to their church, and she wants to learn more about Jesus every day. And so he asks us to continue to pray for her. She was one of the ones that got baptized during that revival week. And then he also asks us to pray for them as they're preparing for mission conference. They're going to be having their first mission conference. And so they're praying for the Lord to bless them in that, and that they would get a heart for missions at that church. All right, so let's pray for the Woodard family and then also for the Elsie family, both of them serving the Lord faithfully, both of them working in church plants, about a year old, and so pray that the Lord gives a good foundation for these churches. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness to us, Lord, that you're the one that blesses our work, and our responsibility, Lord, is not in fruit, it's not in the response, but our responsibility is to you, and Lord, I pray that we would walk uprightly before you, that we would walk in service to you, and that we would follow your leading each and every day. I pray that you would guide our missionaries. I thank you for the Elsie family, for Brother Elsie and his heart for Bolivia, for preaching the word of God, for lifting up Christ. And I thank you for the work you're doing there at their church, Lord, that you've provided this building for them, you've provided a bus for them, and they're seeking to see what great thing can God do with these opportunities. Lord, I pray that you'd continue to lead, guide, and bless there in a wonderful way. I pray that you give his son Matthew wisdom. I pray that you give him understanding as he makes these decisions, that he would know what is your perfect will for his life. And then, Lord, we pray as well for the Woodard family, and they're just starting out in life. They've just had the newest addition to their family, their young son, Jason. Lord, I pray that you'd give them wisdom as they've now come to the mission field with him. They're spending their life there. I pray that you would use them to help this church build a foundation, that it would be a church that is built and grounded on the Word of God. I pray that you would bless this upcoming mission conference as they're seeking to preach the gospel, to get a heart for missions. I pray for the young people in their church, that they would be able to see what it means to be a Christian, what it means to grow up as a Christian. I pray that it would be a start of a wonderful, wonderful ministry that's lifting up Christ in that country. I pray that you get the honor and glory from these missionaries. Lord, I pray you'd get the honor and glory in our lives. May you lead and guide us each and every day of the week. We ask these things now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Would you take your Bibles with me if you would, please? We're going to the book of Genesis. We'll be in the 46th chapter. Genesis chapter 46. We're going to learn of, we've been learning of Joseph's life and the story of Joseph and how God worked. And he said, God sent me before you to preserve your posterity in earth. God did a mighty thing. God sent him. It's a great thing to know when we are sent by God, that God's at work in our lives and doing God's will. Genesis 46, beginning verse number 1, the Bible says, "And Israel took his journey with all that he had and came to Beersheba and offered sacrifices unto the God of his father Isaac. God spake unto Israel in the visions of the night and said, Jacob, Jacob, and he said, Here am I. And he said, I am God, the God of thy father, fear not to go down into Egypt, and I will there make of thee a great nation. And I will go down with thee into Egypt, and I will also surely bring thee up again, and Joseph shall put his hand upon thine eyes. And Jacob rose up from Beersheba, and the sons of Israel carried Jacob their father, and their little ones, and their wives, and the wagons which Pharaoh had sent to carry him. And they took their cattle and their goods, which they had gotten in the land of Canaan, and came into Egypt, Jacob and all his seed with him, and his sons and his sons' sons with him, his daughters and his sons' daughters, and all his seed brought he with him into Egypt. These are the names of the children of Israel which came into Egypt, Jacob and his sons, Reuben's, Jacob's firstborn, the sons of Reuben, Hanok, Phallu, Hezron, and Carmi, the sons of Simeon, Jemuel, and Jamin, and Ohad, and Jachin, and Zohar, and Shaul, the son of a Canaanitish woman, the sons of Levi, Gershon, Kehoth, and Merai. The sons of Judah, and Onan, and Shelah, and Perez, and Zerah. But and Onan died in the land of Canaan, and the sons of Perez were Hezron and Hamul. The sons of Issachar, Tola, and Puva, and Job, and Shimron. The sons of Zebulun, Sered, Elon, and Jaleel. These be the sons of Leah, which she bare unto Jacob, and Padanaram, and his daughters in Dinah. All the souls of his sons and his daughters were 33, and the sons of Gad, and Ziphion, and Haggai, and Shunai, and Esbon, Eri, and Erodi, and Areli. The sons of Asher, Jimna, and Ishua, and Isui, and Beriah, and Sarah, their sisters, and the sons of Beriah, and Heber, and Machil. These are the sons of Zilpah, whom Laban gave to Leah, his daughter, and these she bare unto Jacob, even 16 souls. The sons of Rachel, Jacob's wife, Joseph and Benjamin. And unto Joseph in the land of Egypt were born Manasseh and Ephraim, which Aseneth, the daughter of Potiphar, priest of On, bare unto him. And the sons of Benjamin were Bela, and Becher, and Ashbel, Gera, and Naaman, Ehi, and Rosh, Muppim, and Huppim, and Ard. And these are the sons of Rachel, which were born to Jacob. All the souls were 14. And the sons of Dan, Hushim, and the sons of Naphtali, Jaziel, and Gunai, and Jezer, and Shelem. These are the sons of Bilhah, which Laban gave unto Rachel his daughter. And she bare these unto Jacob. All the souls were 7. And all the souls that came up with Jacob into Egypt that came out of the loins, besides Jacob's sons' wives, all the souls were 66. And the sons of Joseph, which were born him in Egypt, were 2 souls. All the souls of the house of Jacob, which came into Egypt, were 60. And he sent Judah before him unto Joseph to direct his face unto Goshen. And they came into the land of Goshen. And Joseph made ready his chariot and went up to meet Israel, his father, to Goshen, and presented himself unto him. And he fell on his neck and wept on his neck a good while. And Israel said unto Joseph, Now let me die, and since I have seen thy face, because thou art yet alive. And Joseph said unto his brethren and unto his father's house, I will go up and show Pharaoh, and say unto him, My brethren and my father's house, which were in the land of Canaan, are coming to me. And the men of the shepherds, for their trade, have been to feed cattle, and they have brought their flocks and their herds and all that they have. It shall come to pass when Pharaoh shall call you and shall say, What is your occupation? That ye shall say, Thy servant's trade hath been about cattle from our youth even until now, both we and also our fathers. Ye may dwell in the land of Goshen, for every shepherd is an abomination unto the Egyptians. And Joseph is loving them, isn't he? It'd be interesting. I'd like to do the math. I'd see how many people came into Egypt out of the land of Canaan. and discover the whole clan, you know, the whole score of people that came. It's God's people being placed in there. I want to ask our men to come, if they would, and to receive this evening's offering. I'm going to ask Brother Ernie, would you mind coming and leading us in prayer, if you don't mind, please, asking God's blessing on this offering. Oh, wonderful. Great. Plan to be a part of all that's going on in the life of the church. Don't plan to miss anything. God has something for you. I know some things are unavoidable, but do your best to be a part of all things. We're supposed to have some inclement weather. Just go ahead now and plan to be there. And don't plan the other way as if it's not going to happen. You plan to be there, and let's just trust the Lord for it all. All right? Brother Ernie, lead us in prayer if you don't mind. God bless you.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for today. Just thank you that we could come out on this Sunday, Lord. We just pray for this offering, Lord. We pray that you would bless the gift and the giver. We also pray for the upcoming Belton Bible Days, Lord. We pray that the weather would work in our favor, Lord. We also pray for all those that are involved. We just pray that would be we could be a blessing to the area of Belton and the surrounding areas. And we just pray that those that come would be able to just hear the gospel, Lord, and be with the upcoming service, Lord, on Easter. We pray that our church could be a blessing to the surrounding community, Lord. We know that many people only come to church once or twice a year, one of those days being Easter. And we pray, Lord, that we could just share the gospel with those that may not know it, and just be able to invite people out that may not be coming to church normally. And just be with our church, Lord. Thank you for all the ministries that we're part of. And just thank you that we're working church, Lord. And we just ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you so much. I'm going to come to preach the Word of God. Before I do, the lepers are coming to sing. God bless y'all.
Voice behind me whispers,
Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad? Yeah. Would you take your Bibles with me if you would, please? Let's go to the book of James. The book of James. And Jesus does not tempt us, does He? He doesn't. He cannot be tempted, and neither tempts He us. He cannot. He doesn't produce it. You and I are not tempted of God. He was tempted in the form of flesh with Jesus Christ, but you and I cannot be tempted of God. God tempts no man. James, I want to talk to you tonight about the tenth beatitude. In Matthew chapter 5, we're given 9 beatitudes. We know these. Blessed are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. These are the 7 active beatitudes. Here's the 2 passive. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And then verse number 11 says, Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. We find here in the Word of God a 10th beatitude. Or James, this book that we're looking into, was one of the first writings of the New Testament church, one of the earliest writings. And James is writing, he has a heart of a preacher. He's trying to encourage the scattered Christian Jews that have been scattered because of persecution in the church of Jerusalem. He also writes in a flavor, in a way, to present the Lord Jesus Christ. If someone was to pick up this letter that was lost, that they could come to know Christ. If you read the book, you'll discover some of those things. But he's speaking to Christians that are scattered, and he's trying to help them to live the Christian life. He's trying to encourage them. If you know anything about my preaching, you know that the book of James is one of my favorite books. Often I run to it. Some of you like to run to Romans at the end, and that 12th chapter, and that kind of thing, and the first and second verse, and some of you have your own favorites. James is one for me where God has spoken to my heart and used it in my life. We find here a 10th beatitude. Look with me, if you would, in James chapter 1 and verse number 12, where the Bible says, Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. It's a matter of temptation. It comes to all of us, doesn't it? It does. It comes in almost every moment of life. A temptation. We're tempted at every turn. We have sin-filled bodies. We have an old man. We're robed in it. Our hands and our feet and our eyes and our all of it. We like to listen to things that we shouldn't listen to. And we get a certain kind of feeling all over our bodies and in our hearts when we hear certain things. We like to see certain things. And our sight can produce things within our body in a very physical way. Our mouths, for some reason, enjoy telling things we shouldn't be telling and talking in ways we shouldn't be talking. Our hands like to handle things. Our feet, our body likes to enjoy certain pleasures. James writes to this church that's scattered abroad. They're all strewn out all over the place. He said, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation when he is tried. He'll receive a crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love Him." He's trying to get these Jewish Christians scattered abroad to live the Christian life. He tells them something they may not have known before. And that is that there is a crown of life. God will reward those who overcome temptation with a crown in heaven. They'll receive this crown when all of our works are tried. Some will come forth as wood, hay, and stubble, and some will come forth as gold and precious stones. But God says He's going to give us a crown, one that's going to stand the test of fire. And it's the crown of life. And He's promised it to them that love Him. That love Him. It's almost as if we do not love the Lord, we would just give way to temptation. But if we do love the Lord, then there's hope and there's help for us. And we can overcome these temptations by the love of God that lives within us and by the love that we have for Him. Faith worketh by love. What's faith's fuel? Love. Love. Much is said about love in the Word of God. It is the bond of perfectness, completeness, maturity. When we love the Lord, there are certain things we will not do because we will not sin against the love of God. Paul said, "It's the love of God that constrains me. It pulls me in. It's the wind in my sail. It's what keeps me going. It's what makes me capable of doing what I'm doing in my life for Christ." It's a matter of love. It's a big deal. Blessed is the man. When he is tempted, he endures. He'll get a crown of life. James goes on to consider a number of things. I want you to notice with me, if you would, in verses 13 through 16, our own lust. Our own lust. He begins to tell us how temptation comes upon us. And he makes some very plain things. He uses some words of medicine, one that a doctor might be familiar with or a nurse might be familiar with. Those in the medical field would understand. But he begins by saying this, mark it down and make it clear. There's no way that anyone, he says, can say when he's tempted that God has tempted him. Amen. Let no man say when he's tempted, "I am tempted of God." For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth He any man. God never gave in to evil. He doesn't tempt other people with evil either. He tempts none of us with evil. But notice what he says, "But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed." This word lust speaks to the idea of, we're familiar with it in John, 1 John, he says, it's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. This is things that get within us that we think we have to have or we see that we want. The things that we desire, we long for, the desire to do, the desire to have, the desire to be. We think that we deserve it or we want it or we should get it. It looks enticing to us. With our eye, we see. With our ear, we hear. With our hands, we handle. It gets in us and it begins to bang around in us. It's like a ping pong ball that just never stops. You remember that game Pong that Atari came out with, right? And it just keeps bouncing and bouncing and bouncing. And that little bouncy ball never loses its power. Well, lust is the same way. If we're not careful, it gets in us and it entices us. You know what it does? It draws us out. The same term as if you and I were fishing and we had bait on the end of our line. It's trying to get that fish out of its hole, to come out from under its cover, to come and take a good look and a gander at my big, juicy earthworm. And if you're a good fisherman, you've found the best worm out of the bunch, haven't you? Look, this one's fat. Oh, this one's bound. And you'll talk to that little worm and you'll say, "Now go get me a big fish, little worm." And you're hoping that that worm is the juiciest looking thing that's ever been put on the end of a hook and put in front of that fish. And you dangle it out there and you bounce it around and you entice that fish and you jerk it a little bit, trying to hope that that fish will pounce on it for just a moment before it realizes wadded up in that earthworm is a hook that's going to bring that fish onto your dinner plate and your fryer. Yeah. It's the same word, enticed. We see it, we look at it, it entices us, and the devil works. Evil comes from Satan. He does the enticing. You remember when the Lord Jesus Christ, when He was here in flesh, robed in flesh, He was tempted of the devil. The devil is always enticing and tempting. But the Bible says you and I, we get drawn away. We get pulled out from the shelter. We get drawn into the streets. Someone has spiced their bed and they've opened up their door and they've stood outside the door on the corner and they've said, "Come in here, I've made my bed, I've done my things." Enticed. Satan does the enticing work. The Bible says in verse number 15, that when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. This word conceived is a medical word. It speaks about when the lust and the will get together. It produces something. It births something. What does it birth? Sin. What does sin bring about? When it's finished, it brings forth death. You know what that means? It means simply this, that when the lust and the will get together and they have a baby called sin, everything that's wrapped up within that sin has everything within it to kill you, to bring about your death, your ruin. Brings forth death. Years ago, my brother and I, we always ran together, you know. He's about 18 months older than I am. And if he did it, I did it. If I did it, he did it. And every once in a while, we'd get a third wheel in there. In the summertime, we had friends that would come in, one from Minnesota and one from Missouri. One was a better influence than the other. It was kind of what we're going to get ourselves into, you know. And when our friend from Minnesota would come down, it was hard to tell what we'd get into, what we'd come up with. Oftentimes, we'd jump trains. Don't do that, boys and girls. Don't try this at home. The train would come through real slow in our town, and we'd run down there and jump on them trains. Or run beside them and act like we were going to jump on them, and it was stupid. We'd ride our bikes all over our small little town of about 2 square miles, and we thought we owned the place. It was amazing when our friend from Minnesota came down for the summer. I got to meet our police officers on a number of occasions in our little one-horse town. It was hard to tell what would come forth when we would get together. One time, right downtown, right by the bank, right across the street from the 7-Eleven, and right by the police department, stupid, right across from the library, we had cornered a snake, or not a snake, a skunk. It was in this big pine tree, and praise the Lord, it had a rock bed all around it. And so my brother got on one side, and I got on the other side, and my friend Aaron, he got on the other side, and we had this skunk trapped in there. Man, we were chucking rocks like nobody's business, trying to kill that skunk, and sure enough, that skunk let off. Oh, it stunk so bad. Everybody was mad at us. The people who worked at 7-Eleven were mad. The library was mad. The police were mad. The bank was mad. Man, we were just having fun. No telling what we get into, what we produce. That day, I got to ride in a police officer's car. Somebody had bought some Slurpees somewhere and chucked them against a bunch of cars. And because we were out running the streets, they thought we did it. We didn't do it. We smelled like skunks. We said, I promise, we didn't know we were killing skunks. I think he believed us. He didn't have a hard time believing us. But he said, well, let's go see. He said, let's go talk to this attendant down at the 7-Eleven and see if y'all bought these Slurpees. And he said, I want y'all to get in my car. And my friend Aaron, he's a nutcase. He hollered, I got shotgun, you know. Of course, it's a big old shotgun, you know, mounted in on the front seat. And we got to take a ride in the police officer's car. A one and only time, praise the Lord. You can never tell what was going to be birthed when we all got together. Then I had a friend named Nathan from Missouri. And Nathan, he was the son of a preacher and loved the Lord. And anytime Nathan came around for the summer to visit his grandparents, we would have a ton of fun. And we would enjoy ourselves, and we had good, clean fun all the time. Didn't get into crazy things. Playing basketball mainly from, I'd like to say sun up, but that's not true, from about 11 a.m. when we woke up until the lights went out at the annex at about 10:30. We just had a good time. When our will and when our lust get together, the Lord says, you know what's going to be birthed. What's going to be birthed is sin. It brings forth sin. And sin, that sin, it's born to bring forth death. All the components are there. It's all there. In its birth, in its conception. It's all there. It's a terrible thing. We don't always consider the consequences. We don't always consider what we're giving birth to when we decide to put our will together with our lust. When we choose to sin. And the Lord says, blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he's tried, he's going to receive a crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. And James says in verse 16, with compassion, the heart of a preacher, he says, do not err, my beloved brethren. Stay away. Stay away from sin. He not only talks about our lust, but he talks about the Lord's work in our life. He says in verse number 17, this is in contrast to what you and I can produce, what our will and our lust produces. This is in contrast. God says, or James says this in verse 17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. It's birthed from heaven, and it comes down from the Father of lights. There's all goodness and holiness and brightness. And he says, with whom is no variableness? He's never worse, and he's never better. He's always good. There's neither shadow of turning. There's no place where God's light is hid from. God's gifts, and God is always good. And God desires to produce this in you, and he will. And notice verse 18, of his own will, notice this word. Here it is, begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creature. You know what he's saying? God did not birth you again so that you could birth sin. God birthed you again so that you could be like him. That you would be the first fruits of his creatures. You would be in his image. So James says, how are you going to produce this in your life? Verse 19, wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. The wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Just because you're loud and angry doesn't mean you're right. Sometimes in America, we think that he who's loudest is right. And people protest and they throw fire bombs and break windows and flip police officer cars over and take over cities. Just because they're the loudest doesn't mean they're right. Nor in our church setting, when we consider the righteousness of God and the holiness of God and the standard of God, just because there's a crowd out there making these great posts on Facebook, and they're making a lot of noise and stirring things up and talking about how it's just Jesus and me, I don't care what you think, and I'm only accountable to God, and all those types of things. And they don't consider the fruit of the Spirit in their life, that it actually produces some things in their lives. The Lord says, you are my first fruits. In other words, your accountability to me produces some things in your life that look like Jesus. He says, just because people are loud doesn't mean they're right. Just because they're angry about something doesn't mean they're telling the truth. That doesn't produce the righteousness of God. So what does he say? Verse 21. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness to the max degree, and receive with meekness, notice this, the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. That engrafted word means the thing that's born in you. The placed in word. How are you and I born again? Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. The word of truth. It's been placed in you. And so James says, look, you have your own lusts. And those lusts, they're in you. You have desires, no doubt about it, but you have a will that governs those desires. But if you give way, if you allow your will and your lusts to get together, it's going to produce some nasty things that's not pleasing to God. It's going to produce sin, and that sin is going to destroy your life. But God has placed something within you, dear Christian. He has birthed something in you that's contrary to your original nature. That's contrary to your natural birth. My spirit, the spirit of truth, the word of truth, it's alive in you. Amen. And so the things that you would do, you can't do because God is in you. So we must grow. We must grow. And so, how do we work this out? Verse 22. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. What does that mean? It means you can't come to church and just sit and hear and listen. and think you're doing God some great favor. It means this: the Christian life is not about church attendance. Oh, Johnny got a star today for attendance. Johnny's had perfect attendance all year long. Let's give him a trophy. God says, that's not it. Amen. Are we to be together and to encourage one another and fellowship and get in the Word and study and attend church faithfully? Of course we are. God requires of that. But that's not the end of the Christian life. Amen. That's not it. If you think bringing your kids to church and setting them in a pew and that's the max of your Christian life, and you expect them to turn out well for God, it's not it. It's not it. It's better than some, but that's not it. Don't deceive yourself. Don't cheat yourself. Don't think that you're really helping yourself, because you're not. You're deceiving your own self. Verse 23, for if man, any man be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man beholding in the his natural face in a glass. He beholdeth himself and goes his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. Notice this. This is what it's like. It's like the man that wakes up in the morning, is in the hurry, he runs to the mirror, he looks at himself real quick, and then he runs. The Lord says, you hear the word, but you don't really give heed to it. You don't allow the Word of God to make any change in your life. You go on quickly, speedily to the next thing. But notice what he says. Verse 25. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. You know what that means? That means the man looks in the mirror and he makes some changes. He allows it to take effect in his life. He allows that mirror, the image that he sees, the things that he sees in that mirror, he allows it to affect his life and his decisions. And he begins to change some things about his appearance. God doesn't care what you look like, how you dress, how you behave, hogwash. God says, I have a desire to make a difference in you. You have to be a doer of the word. If we look into the perfect law of liberty and continue therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. You know what God is saying? God's word, this is the mirror. And as we look and see what God says, and we hear what God says, and we hearken to what God says, we do. This man is blessed in his deeds. This is what God does. All we've been talking about, this is what God does. We have our will, but when we get born again, there's something birthed within us, and God makes a difference in our lives. You can't take up God and not be changed, not be different. You can't do it. You just can't do it. Can you take fire into your bosom and not be burned? No. Well, you can't take Christ into your heart and not be different, not be changed. He's a consuming fire. And look what he desires. Verse number 26. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. It's the second time we've heard this word deceive. Verse 22 says, be you doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. It's empty. It's empty. God makes a difference in our lives, doesn't he? The tongue is just an indicator of the heart, isn't it? Amen. The condition of the heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And so you can be a whitewashed sepulcher. You can have all the outward appearances of a Christian, and you got your shoes polished, you got on your matching nice blue socks, and you got on your suit that a friend gave to you, and you got on a belt that matches your shoes, and you got your tie on, and you got your suit jacket with your pocket square. You got your watch. Got my Bible under my arm. You can be a whitewashed sepulcher, but your tongue's going to tell on you. It's the indicator of the condition of your heart. God doesn't want to just polish you up. He wants to change your heart. And He can change your heart. And He will change your heart if you allow Him to. He says, a lot of people walking around with empty religion. Verse 27. Pure religion. Clean, undefiled. The stuff is good before God. That which is undefiled before God and the Father is this. To visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction. And to keep himself unspotted from the world. And we like to talk about visiting the fatherless and the widows. We don't like to talk much about being unspotted from the world. We like the good works, the visible things that everybody's going to say, oh, you are such a good Christian. I love the way you're all the time working with those orphans. Oh, you're such a good Christian. You deliver all those meals to all those widows. And that's great. God says we ought to. Sometimes we're so much more interested in doing the things that are visible as opposed to doing the things that are between me and the Lord. He says, keeping himself unspotted from the world. This means to keep on keeping myself unspotted from the world. To keep on keeping myself unspotted from the world. It's a constant battle. I'm tempted all the time. My lusts, man, there's a lot of fish, there's a lot of worms hanging out there, and they're trying to entice me. But I'm supposed to keep myself from those vices, unspotted from the world. Oh, I don't want to go to heaven with a bunch of holes in my mouth from fish hooks. Do you? I like trout fishing. I'm not a big boat fisherman. I enjoy it if somewhere I go with somebody that knows what they're doing, but I don't know how to do it. I was talking with some folks about that the other day. I'd love to learn, and I'm looking forward. Someone's offered me a trip to go catch some big fish out in the sea, and I'm looking forward to that and trying to get that scheduled. But I like trout fishing, getting on the waders and walking the stream and having my pole, and it's just me and nature and the stream. And I love, you know, the brook running and rustling through all the rocks, and you feel the pressure on the backs of your legs or the front of your legs or whatever it is, and it's awesome. You can't get in those cold streams, those natural streams like that. You're only hot from about the waist up, you know. Everything else is cold. Your feet are cold. Your legs are cold. You can have the most fun and the hottest day out there in the stream, and you just get to move around and fish. And sometimes I go to these parks. I've been at Spring State Park or Montauk State Park. I've been to the San Juan River and fished out in Bloomfield, New Mexico, around the Farmington area. And sometimes it's catch and release. You're fishing and you're catching fish that other people have caught before. Sometimes you'll get them in and you'll realize, stupid fish. How many times are you going to take the bait? They got holes all in their mouth. They're cut from, you know, the corner of their mouth back to their gill. Your hook is hardly staying in this big old giant hole that's been snagged about 10, well, it's not that big, but you get what I'm saying. And you just think, come on, fish. Someone said to me that goldfish have about a 2-second memory. I don't know what other fish have, but Sometimes we're just like that, aren't we? When it comes to sin and the enticement and lust, we just take the bait and we keep taking it. And we keep taking it. And we got scars all over us and holes in our mouth. Our tongue's hurting all the time. And our jawbone, man, you ever catch them? Sometimes them stupid fish, they'll swallow that hook and get it down in their gut. Oh, that's terrible. And you know the fish isn't going to live, but it's catch and release. So you've got to, you just have to kind of snip your string and let that fish try to digest that hook. They're not going to make it. They'll make it for a little while. Sometimes Christians are the same way. As a pastor, you see it. You see it over and over and over and over again. And you wonder how long they're going to make it. Wonder when they're going to take it hook, line, and sinker. Wonder when they're finally going to get them. They're going to swallow it. And boy, when they take it in, that thing is birthed. And it's just going to kill them from the inside out. Thank you, Lord. We have our will. Temptation comes. And we're enticed. God has birthed something within us that can help us to stay away from the temptation. God says, it's my word. Don't just be a hearer. Be a doer of it. Hear and then hearken. Hear and then hearken. Hear and hearken. Hear and hearken. Be a doer. Give way to God. Let Him have His way with you. Say yes to God. Sin and lust and the will, when they get together, there is something nasty produced that you don't want to deal with. You don't want that thing alive. Don't give it any hope. Don't give it any hope. Abort it. Give way to God. Let Him have His way with you. Let's stand to our feet together, may we? This is a warning about sin. This is the 10th beatitude. Blessed is the man when he is tempted. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life. Blessed is he that endureth temptation. Some of us need to pray tonight for God's help. We struggle. We have vices. We have things we give way to time and time and time again. We go after the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of the life. We're like that bass. It's ready to strike. When the right thing comes by and the right jiggle happens, the right bait is put out, you'll take it. You'll take it. Seek the Lord. Love Him. Surrender it all to the Lord. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you need Him today. He loves you with an everlasting love. And He will save you. He will save you. We're going to sing hymn number 154. All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I'll ever love and trust Him in His presence. Daily live. 154. Let's sing it together, may we? All to Jesus.
All to Jesus I surrender.
All to Him I freely give.
I will ever love.
Someone's helping me to know. Good.
To Jesus.
Good. We have time. We are fine. Praise the Lord. Thank you, gentlemen. God is wanting to do something within us. You have the power within you, if you know Christ as Savior, to overcome temptation and evil and lust. You have it. You have all the answers. The answers are in the Lord. The answers are in His Word. Spend time with Him. Listen to Him. Get a word from God. You'll not want to sin against Him. Accountability partner, you want one? You can't keep him 24/7. You can't keep an accountability partner 24/7. You know as well as I do, sometimes it's the matter of the mind. He can't get in there with you. She can't get in there with you. Your wife who lives with you can't keep you clean and pure before God. We have to have the Holy Spirit of God helping us and guiding us. And He's been birthed in us. It's all you need. He's all you need. He's all we need. Amen. Good. Well, I appreciate your attention this evening. I pray that God by His Spirit has spoken to you. I want to try to give you some practical things that can help you to live the Christian life, to honor God. Okay? I've been told right now it's just thunder. There's no rain coming down or anything. There is a warning, I guess, off to the west of us. I don't know how far west. They didn't tell me, but maybe nobody knows. So, good. Brother Jacob, tell us just a couple quick things, and then we'll be good. I belabored the prayer time, so.
The weather outside looks fine for right now, so we should be fine going home. No need to alarm yourself right now about those tornado warnings as of right now. Yes. Just a few announcements. This upcoming Sunday is Easter Sunday, and we're having our candy throw. We have candy on these back tables, but we need more candy. We want lots and lots of candy, right? And so I think our goal is usually between 300 to 500 pounds of candy. And you say, that's a lot for one kid. Yes, it is. But we have a lot of children. And between the bus ministry and all the different children that are going to be here for Easter Sunday, it'll definitely get divvied out. And so we're hoping to have all of that in by Wednesday so that we can gauge what it is that we'll need to make sure that we have enough. And so if we can get it by Wednesday, that'll help us get a good count for that candy. So if you have candy that you haven't brought in or you're planning on getting candy, Wednesday would be the deadline for that. And then also, if you have taken the child safety training or you were in our meeting for child safety training and your link expired, all of those are going to go active again tonight. And I believe they'll be active for another week or two after that again. So those will all go active tonight. If you weren't able to complete it, that'll be up and active again for you to complete. All right, let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Our Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your goodness. Lord, I'm so thankful that You are faithful to us. I pray that we would rely on You, that we would live before You, Lord, in honesty and accountability. I pray that You'd lead and guide us each day. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
I am so glad that you have chosen to watch this service online. I pray that God has spoken to your heart. There's absolutely nothing greater than knowing that God from heaven reached down with His voice and spoke to you. The great question now is, what will your response be to God? If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then trust Him today. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. If you've never followed Christ in obedience through baptism, then be baptized. If you're not attending church, I challenge you to be a part of this church if you're in our local area. If not, find a church just like this one and become a member of it. I want to help you to do God's will with your life. And ultimately, I know that's what you want too. You want to do God's will. On our website, you'll find a number of ways in which our church can care for you spiritually. I would love to hear what God is doing in your life. Please Stay in touch.